journey of faith, know that you are most welcome here to see the richness of God's love given for you. And what was that? 10:30. So in like 4 hours, 100 people made up of confirmation students and their pastors or youth leaders who love them will descend on our Crossroads campus. And they will come from all parts of the states, from urban and suburban and even rural Lutheran churches, to be part of the Senate's confirmation camp. Originally, if you were ever part of the confirmation camp. So these young people, for 1 week, they will embark on learning and living out their faith in a safe and really cool place. Now, confirmation camp is a 2-year cycle for the curriculum. Last year, our kids lived through the Exodus, and this year is the Jesus year. So throughout the week, the lessons and the games and the activities are focused on what it means to follow Jesus and what a difference that makes in our ordinary lives. And then, in 6 days from now, at like 6:30 a.m., right? 23 high school students from Living Waters and Zionwood will drag themselves out of bed to get to Zionwood to get into cars and sleep. And the adults will drag them down to Rehoboth, Delaware. For 4 weeks, they will serve a community thrift store in the mornings. And in 1 evening, we'll go to the Missouri Synod Lutheran Church in town, whose ministry it is to care for the large international population that comes to beach towns like Rehoboth for the summer, to work at the jobs that very few will, cooking, housekeeping, caring for the tourists. Our youth will help prepare the dinner and will eat with these young people, most who are just a year or two older than them, and listen to their stories. For a week, our high school kids will live together in one house, serve together, worship, and care for one another. So our confirmation kids and our high school kids get camp in Rehoboth. And the rest of us get today's text, inviting us to the same thing, the same invitation to learn the Jesus way of life. Now Jesus uses language that maybe we aren't too familiar with, talking about yokes. The invitation is the same. It's as if Jesus is saying, take my teachings, take my life, take my spirit, take the way that I live, and learn from me. Learn from me instead of learning from those who only care about laws and judging without the word of grace. Now, he in particular was talking about the religious clergy of the day, Pharisees. And the religion of the Pharisees was 1,000 rules and regulations which essentially said no, 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 no to everything. Negative. Whereas the religion of Jesus was simple and freeing. Not easy, but simple and freeing. You get to love God and your neighbor. You get to love the Lord your God with all your heart and your mind and your soul and your neighbor the way that you love yourself. You're free to show mercy, to love and to be kind. You are free to have faith and move mountains. Jesus' religion was made up of simple positives, like worshiping God together, like standing up for the oppressed and practicing mercy. And the mood of his religion was that of a wedding feast, something full of joy and celebration, which didn't always go over so well all the time with those in church. Jesus does another thing when he's talking to his disciples today, when he comes to explaining how God works. Now, as individuals, we come up with so many pictures and ideas of how we think God works, and Jesus gives us a very clear picture in the text. God is the one who bears our burdens. God is the one who shows up in our need. God is the one who comes alongside of us. And nothing demonstrates this more than the cross. God's willingness to embrace all of our life, even to the point of death in Jesus, to demonstrate God's profound loving commitment that will not be stopped or deterred by anything. Now that's not necessarily what we want. We often refer comfort a God who takes away our problems instead of helping us cope with them. A God who eliminates our challenges rather than equipping us for them. Or a God who vanquishes our enemies rather than enabling us to make peace with them. Again, that's not usually what we want, but it's pretty much exactly what we need. And all of this should shape not only our picture of the God we know in Jesus, but what it means to live a life of Jesus. Which means what this passage is not about is self-care, but discipleship. This isn't Jesus saying, take care of yourself, if you don't, you will. But rather, as you live your life following me, I'm going to be with you. Now, self-care matters very much. But I don't want us to get confused between good news and good advice. And while good advice is helpful, it doesn't save us. The good news is that God always shows up where we least expect God to be, usually in the need of our neighbor, in the person who doesn't look anything like you, and the person who believes and thinks and acts differently than you do, just as importantly than we think they should. And in all those circumstances, our invitation is the same. To care for them, to meet them where they are, and to accept them as we are able. It's simple, but not easy work. But as we undertake that kind of discipleship, we discover that God and Jesus is already there to meet us. Waiting for us, encouraging us, forgiving us, which is what makes the burden light. And the yoke not easy, but joyful. We live in a culture where we're increasingly taught to believe that true joy and deep satisfaction and the realization of what we're created for comes through individual self-discovery and individual self-expression, being authentic to one's true self. And while there is great value in that kind of authenticity, I'm not sure we can achieve those things apart from being in relationship with and bearing the burden of those around us. And so God shows up where we least expect God to be, to call us to the same place and discover ourselves as we turn away from ourselves to meet the other and to find our